Okay, dear students, in this class for Macbeth, we have to have a small recap of scenes 1 and 2 of Act 4, and let us proceed with scene 3 onwards. So first, let us have a quick recap of what happens in scene 1 in Act 4, and then we shall proceed with from scene 3 onwards. I think you can see, we can see the screen now. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. In Act 4, Scene 1, Macbeth again meets the witches. The three witches, he has actually planned in this meeting, we have the three witches here. Again, thunder and lightning were in the backdrop. They were having a boiling cauldron in the middle and they were dancing around it. And three witches are adding some ingredients in the cauldron. They are dancing around the cauldron and throwing into some poisoned entrails, right? And what are the things they are adding? You can see a poisoned frog, pellet that is a boiler, a slice of a swamp snake, a nude's eye that is a lizard, a frog's tongue, fur from a bat, a dog's tongue, the forked tongue of an adder. Adder means a small snake. You can see the list here. The forked tongue of an adder, the stinger of a burrowing worm, a lizard's leg, an owl's wing. All these things are added in the broth. And they are having a huge cauldron in the middle and adding all these ingredients in it. And the third witch also adds up some more ingredients, like the scale of a dragon, a wolf's tooth, a witch's mummified flesh, the gullet and stomach of a ravenous shark, a root of hemlock. Hemlock was a poisonous root that was dug up in the dark, a Jew's liver, a goat's bile, some twigs of yew, right? A Turk's nose, a Tartar's lips, a finger of a baby that was strangled as a prostitute gave birth to it in a ditch. So all these things are added up in the broth. And the Hecate, the chief of the three witches, enters with the other three witches, well done. And she admires and congratulates the efforts made by the witches. And now Macbeth enters and meets the witches here. So he demands the witches what they were doing, but they are not ready to answer him. They say that a deed without a name, we are indulging in a deed that is without a name we are doing. So it is a secret and evil ritual they are performing in the cauldron. And he commands the witches to speak up. And he says, Macbeth, I don't know how you know the things you do, but I insist that you answer my questions. Look at the way in which Macbeth addresses the three witches. I command you in the name of whatever dark powers you serve. I don't care if you unleash violent winds that tear down churches, make the foamy waves overwhelm ships and sail and send sailors to their deaths. Flatten crops and trees, make castles fall down on their inhabitants' heads, make palaces and pyramids collapse, and mix up everything in nature. Tell me what I want to know. So the witches are also ready to answer the witch, Macbeth, the questions, right? He just questions, thunder is there, right? First apparition, the first spirit appears, It says, Macbeth, 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 you have to be beware of Macduff, who is the Thane of Fife. That is the first warning given to Macbeth. Please make note, the first apparition, the ghost appears, a spirit appears and gives a warning saying that, Macbeth, you have to be careful about Macduff, who was the Thane of Fife. That is how the first apparition disappears. Next, the second apparition also appears and it says, you have to be violent, bold and firm, laugh at the power of other men. You need not be worried or you need not be disturbed. You can laugh at the power of people because nobody born of a woman can ever harm Macbeth. What was the first prediction given by the witch? Macbeth has to be very careful about Macduff, the Thane of Fife. Second warning is given by the second witch. That is, you have to be bold, violent and firm. And he need not be worried at all because no man born out of woman shall harm Macbeth. So Macbeth was immediately very happy, right? Because all human beings need to be born out of women. So it is impossible that no human being can hurt Macbeth. So Macbeth immediately says, then I don't need to kill Macduff at all, because when the first apparition gives a prediction, Macbeth immediately thinks of killing Macduff. Right? Even before the second spirit speaks, in the meantime, Macbeth was thinking about killing Macduff, because it has spoken that you have to be very careful about Macduff. Immediately, Macbeth thinks of killing Macduff. When the second apparition gives a warning, gives a hopeful idea that no man born out of a woman shall harm Macbeth, Macbeth was very happy. So he says, I need not kill Macduff. I have no reason to fear him, but I will make doubly sure. That is how Macbeth immediately changes his mind back, that in order to make double sure, I will kill him tonight. That is how I can sleep peacefully at night. A third ghost also appears and says, be brave like the lion and be proud. You need not be worry about who hates you or who resents you and who conspires against you. Macbeth will never be defeated until Birnam Wood marches to fight you at Dunsinane Hill. Macbeth need not worry or need not be afraid at all until the forest of Birnam Wood. Wood means forest. Until the Birnam forest enters near the Dunsinane Hill. Please, my dear students, make note of all the important names I am mentioning during my presentation so that you can be, it can be very useful for your examinations. Since most of the examinations will be conducted with only objective type questions, you have to remember all the names of the names I am mentioning in my lecture. So please make note, the name of the forest is Birnam Wood, B-I-R-N-A-M-W-O-O-D, Birnam Wood. The castle in which Macbeth is living as a king is called as Dunsinane Hill, D-U-N-S-I-N-A-N-E, Dunsinane Hill, right? So Macbeth will never be defeated until Birnam Wood marches to fight you at Dunsinane Hill. Is it practically possible? Is it feasible? How can a forest ever march to fight against Macbeth at Dunsinane Hill? Is it going to happen? It will never happen at all. Macbeth immediately acknowledges that it will never happen. Who can command the forest and make the trees pull their roots out of their earth and they can walk and come to Dunsinane Hill? So nobody, it will never happen at all. So I can be totally at peace. So They also give a procession, the three witches. They also make a procession appear in front of him with eight kings marching across the stage. And the last one, the last king with a mirror in his hand, followed by the ghost of Banquo. Please make note. The three witches arranged for a parade, a march of eight kings on the stage, across the stage. And the last of the ghost, the eighth one, was holding a mirror in his hand, followed by the ghost of Banquo. So Macbeth was again totally irritated and he demanded the reason why these eight kings appeared. It was a horrible sight, and he imagines that they were all descendants of Banquo. Banquo appears with his blood-clotted hair, is smiling at me and pointing to them as his. Blood has clotted in his hair because there were strong wounds, and Banquo's head appears in the last. First witch says, okay, come on, cheer up, Macbeth. Macbeth was so horrified by the appearance of the march past. So come on, cheer him up. Right? The three witches try to change the mood of Macbeth. And in scene one continues with Lennox and Macbeth. Macduff has fled to England. Immediately he was inquiring about Macduff because he has planned to kill him. And Lennox informs him that Macduff had escaped to England. In scene 2, we come across the house of Macduff, where there was Lady Macduff along with her son. The messenger Ross comes and meets her. Before he leaves, he gives a warning to escape from the place. And Lady Macduff was very angry about her husband, who has left her as well as her child without any protection. Right? She was so angry about her husband that he has left her without any protection in the household. That is why she was very much angry. And she was arguing with her son, the small boy. But the son says, I still believe my father. My father was not a coward. That is how the son says. But Lady Macduff irritates him, saying that your father is dead and how are you going to lead your rest of your life? And Lady Macduff also says that your father was a traitor, Drohi. That is how she calls him. And because he has made a promise that he would protect her, but he has left her in the middle. So Ross gives a messenger comes. He also gives the same kind of warning to leave the place as early as possible because the murderers are planning to come and kill them. In scene two, we can see the murderers entering the house and killing Lady Macduff and also the small boy. So we can see the cruelty of Macbeth, in which he has sent murderers to kill a lady without any protection, that is Lady Macduff as well as the son of Macduff. Now we proceed with scene 3 of Act 4. Enter Malcolm and Macduff. Let us seek out some shady place where we can sit down alone and cry out our hearts out. Malcolm says, Macduff, instead of crying, let's keep hold of our swords and defend our fallen homeland like honorable men. Each day, new widows howl, new orphans cry, and new sorrows slap heaven in the face, until it sounds like heaven itself feels Scotland's anguish and screams in pain. This line signifies the cruelty of Macbeth and the continuation of murders in Scotland. Macbeth has gone into a killing spree. He has been continuously ordering for killing people who are all against him. So that shows that Macbeth has become a brutal murderer who has been continuously murdering people who are all against him. Malcolm says, I consider it my duty to avenge whatever I believe is wrong. And I believe whatever I am sure it's true, I'll put right whatever I can when the time comes. What you just said may perhaps be true. This tyrant ruler, that is Macbeth, whose mere name is so awful it hurts us to say, it was once considered an honest man. We all believed Macbeth to be an honest man once. Now he has become a traitor and a tyrant. Tyrant means a kodungol arasan. You were one of his favorites. He hasn't done anything to harm you yet. I am inexperienced, but you are planning to win Macbeth's favor by betraying me to him. So Malcolm, the young and eldest prince, he also doubts Macduff, because he may be sent by Macbeth. I am not ready to believe you, says Malcolm to Macduff. He says, I am not treacherous, I am not a traitor. But Macbeth is a traitor. Even someone with a good and virtuous nature might give way to a royal command. But I beg your pardon, my fears can't actually make you evil. Angels are still bright even through Lucifer. The brightest angel fell from heaven. I have to doubt everyone. I have lost my hope of convincing you to fight against Macbeth. Malcolm says, maybe you lost your hopes about me where I found my doubts about you. Why did you leave your wife and child vulnerable, the most precious things in your life, those strong bonds of love? How could you leave them behind? But I beg you, Malcolm is doubting Macduff, how he has left his wife and child without any protection. Macduff says, bleed, bleed, poor country, great tyrant, go ahead and build yourself up, because good people are afraid to stand up to you. Enjoy everything you stole because your title is safe. Farewell, Lord. I wouldn't be the villain you think. I am even, I were offended, offered all of Macbeth's kingdom and the riches of the East too. Right? இதுக்கு மேல பேசி உன்னை புரிய வைக்க முடியாது. I am ready to leave, says Macduff. Malcolm immediately says, I am just testing you. Don't be offended. I don't completely distrust you. I do think Scotland is sinking under Macbeth's oppression. Our country is weeping. It bleeds. And each day, a fresh cut is added to her wounds. I also think there would be many people willing to fight for me. That is how Malcolm tested Macduff in the beginning. That is the quality of a prince, not to believe everyone immediately. Can you understand this? Are you able to follow me, what I am saying? Bhavadharani? Bhavadharani, can you unmute your mic and tell me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, why did Malcolm not believe Macduff in the beginning? Answer panunga, Bhavadharani. Zero to Bhavadharani, unmute your mic and answer.
Sir.
கேக்குதுல நான் சொல்றது கேக்குது தமிழ்ல தான
பேசுறேன். He left his wife and his children, sir.
சொல்லுங்கமா.
Because he left his wife and children.
Okay. Why did he doubt him? Malcolm wanted to test his integrity. அவன் நம்பிக்கையை டெஸ்ட் பண்றதா அப்படி சொல்றார். Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Who are you talking about? I'm talking about myself. I know I have so many vices that when people see them all around exposed, evil Macbeth will see him as pure as snow in comparison, and poor Scotland will call him sweet lamb when they compare him to me and my infinite evils. Still, Malcolm is not fully convinced. இப்பய் நம்பல. நீ நல்லா யோசிச்சுக்கப்பா. I am not as good as Macbeth. When you compare me with Macbeth, Macbeth is far better. Because I am much more worse. எப்படி? He will give a list. பாருங்க. Macbeth says, even in hell you couldn't find a devil worse than Macbeth, he says. But he says, I admit that he is murderer, lecherous, greedy, lying, deceitful, violent, malicious, and guilty of every sin that has a name. But there is no end, absolutely none, to my sexual desires. Malcolm says, I am a very sexual pervert. Macbeth is an evil person, I no doubt about it. But I have my own evil qualities. Because he says, I am a sexual pervert. Your wives, your daughters, your old women and your young maids together could not satisfy my lust. That is how Malcolm says. My desire would overpower all restraints and anyone who stood in my way. It would be better for Macbeth to rule than someone like me. என்னை விட மேக்பத் எவ்வளவோ பரவாயில்லைன்னு மேல்கமே சொல்றாரு. எதுக்காக? அகைன் டெஸ்டிங் மேக்டஃப். Macbeth says, endless greed and lust in a man's nature is a kind of tyranny. It has caused the downfall of many kings. But don't be afraid to take the crown that belongs to you. இது உங்க அப்பா உனக்கு கொடுத்த நியாயப்படி நீ இருக்க வேண்டிய ராஜாவுடைய பதவி. You have to come and accept it. So there are enough women in Scotland to satisfy your lust. Please come to Scotland. That is how Macduff says. He says, I am also not only full of lust, I am also incredibly greedy. If I became king, I would steal the nobles' lands, taking jewels from one guy and houses from another. The more I had, the greedier I would grow until I would invent false quarrels with my good and royal subjects, destroying them so I could get my hands on their wealth. I am a greedy fellow. First, he says, I am full of lust. Second, he says, I am filled with jealousy and greedy. He says, I am not worried about it. Don't worry. Scotland has enough treasures to satisfy you out to your own royal coffers. These bad qualities are bearable when balanced against your good sides. I know you are a good man. Please come to Scotland. That is how Macduff still argues. But I don't have any good sides. I don't have a trace of qualities a king needs, such as justice, truth, moderation, stability, generosity. These are the qualities required for a king. Note it down. Justice, truth, moderation, stability, generosity, perseverance, mercy, humility, devotion, patience, courage, and bravery. All these qualities are also hailed by Thiruvalluvar in his Thirukkural. Right? எடுத்து பார்த்தா தெரியும் உங்களுக்கு. ஜஸ்டிஸ் இருக்கணும், ட்ரூத் இருக்கணும், மாடரேஷன். ரெண்டு பக்கம் பாதகம் வராமல் என்ன செய்யணும்? நீதி தவறாமல் நீதி வழங்கக்கூடிய தன்மை இருக்கணும், ஸ்டெபிலிட்டி இருக்கணும், ஜெனராசிட்டி இறக்க குணம் இருக்கணும், பெர்சிவரன்ஸ் கடைசி வரைக்கும் ஃபைட் பண்ணக்கூடிய ஸ்பிரிட் இருக்கணும், மர்சி இறக்க குணம் இருக்கணும், ஹியூமிலிட்டி பணிவு இருக்கணும், டிவோஷன் பக்தி இருக்கணும், பேஷன்ஸ் பொறுமை இருக்கணும், கரேஜ் அது தைரியம் அண்ட் பிரேவரி விடாப்படியாக ஃபைட் பண்ணக்கூடிய ஸ்கில்ஸ் இருக்கணும். ஸோ இதெல்லாம் என்னது? குவாலிட்டிஸ் ரெக்வயர்ட் ஃபார் அ கிங். பட் ஐ டோன்ட் ஹாவ் எனி திங் மேக்டஃப். ஓ ஸ்காட்லண்ட் ஸ்காட்லண்ட் அழுக ஆரம்பிச்சான் மேல்கம். மேக்டஃப் இஸ் நவ் கிரைங். ஹி சேஸ், இஃப் சம்மன் லைக் மீ இஸ் ஃபிட் டு பி கிங், லெட் மீ நோ. ஐ ரியலி ஆம் எக்ஸாக்ட்லி ஆஸ் ஐ ஹவ் டிஸ்கிரைப் மை செல்ஃப் டு யூ. என்ன செய்யறது? மேக்டஃப் சேஸ், ஃபிட் டு பி கிங், யூ ஆர் நாட் ஃபிட் டு லிவ். ஓ வந்துருச்சு மேக்டஃப்க்கு. அவன் மோசம்னு சொல்லி ஓன்ட்ட வந்து கம்ப்ளைண்ட் பண்ண என்ன செய்யற? நீ அதை விட மோசமா இருக்கியே. ஓ மிசரபிள் நேஷன் மை ஸ்காட்லாண்ட், ரூல்ட் பை அன் அசர்பிங் மர்டரஸ் டைரண்ட், வென் வில் யூ சி எ பீஸ்ஃபுல் டேஸ் அகெயின்? த மேன் ஹூ ஹஸ் அ லீகல் ரைட் டு த த்ரோன் இஸ் பை ஹிஸ் ஓன் அட்மிஷன் எ கர்ஸ்ட் மேன் அண்ட் எ டிஸ்கிரேஸ் டு த ராயல் ஃபேமிலி. யுவர் ராயல் ஃபாதர் டன்கன் வாஸ் அ வர்ச்சுவஸ் கிங். யுவர் மதர் ஸ்பெண்ட் மோர் டைம் ஆன் ஹர் நீஸ் இன் பிரேயர் than she did standing up. She lived a life of absolute piety. Goodbye. Get lost. The evils you have described inside yourself have driven me out of Scotland forever. Oh, my heart, your hope is dead. எரிச்சலின் உச்சத்துக்கே போயிட்டான் மேக்டஃப். ஏன்னா தன்னை பத்தியே மேல்கம் இவ்வளவு மோசமா சொன்ன பிறகு தெர் இஸ் நோ யூஸ் ஆஃப் ஆஸ்கிங் ஹிம் டு கம் பேக் டு ஸ்காட்லண்ட். நவ் மேல்கம் ரிவீல்ஸ் இஸ் ட்ரூ நேச்சர். மேக்டஃப், திஸ் பேஷனேட் அவுட்பர்ஸ்ட், இமோஷனல் அவுட்பர்ஸ்ட், விச் ப்ரூவ்ஸ் யுவர் இன்டெகிரிட்டி. சோ ஃபார் ஐ ஹவ் ஒன்லி டெஸ்டட் யூ, இதுவரை உன்னை சோதித்தோம். கடவுள் பண்ண வர திருவிளையாடல் அது மாதிரி சொல்றாரு. I did, I have told everything about me is wrong. It is only false. It has removed my doubts and about you made me realize that you are really a trustworthy and an honorable man. The devil Macbeth has tried many times to trick me because I am not ready to believe anyone very easily and lure me into his power, and prudence prevents me to believing people too quickly. Very important line. Why did Malcolm accuse himself to be a person filled with lust and greediness? Because he doubted Macduff to be one of the messengers, one of the persons sent by Macbeth. So he was not ready to believe Macduff initially. So he was not ready to believe people too quickly. He says, with God as my witness, I will let myself be guided by you. I take back my confession. I take back all the bad things I said about myself, because none of those flaws are really part of my character. I am really a virgin. I have never told a lie. Now, போய் சொன்னதே கிடையாது. I am still a virgin. I have never told a lie. I barely care about what I already own, let alone feel jealous of another's possession. நான் யார் மேலே ஆசைப்பட்டது கிடையாது. யாருடைய உடைமைக்கும் ஆசைப்பட்டதில்லை. I have never broken a promise. I wouldn't betray the devil himself. I love truth as much as I love life. The lies I told about my character are actually the first false words I have ever spoken. The person who I really am is ready to serve you and our poor country. Indeed, before you arrived here, old Sivert, the king of England, with the 10,000 soldiers already prepared for battle. The king of England, the prince of England, old Sivert, all these people joined together to fight against Macbeth. So with the 10,000 soldiers already prepared for battle, was making his way here. Now we will fight Macbeth together and make the chances of our success be as great as the justice of our cause. Why are you silent? It is hard to make sense of such different stories. Now Macduff couldn't understand what to believe and whom to believe. A doctor enters. Well, we'll speak more soon to the doctor. Is King Edward coming out? Yes, sir. A crowd of sick people is waiting for him to heal them. Their illness confounds the most advanced techniques of modern medicine, but when he touches them, they heal immediately because of the power granted to him by heaven. Because even in the English court, people believed in the divine right theory that kings were all messengers of gods themselves. Even sick people are cured by the touch of the king. Thank you, Dr. Macduff. What disease is he talking about? It is called the evil. Edward's healing touch is a miracle that I have seen him perform many times during my stay in England. How he receives his gifts from heaven, only he can say. But he cures people with strange conditions, all swollen, plagued by ulcers and pitiful to look at. Patients who are beyond the help of surgery, by placing a gold coin around their necks and saying holy prayers over them. That is how King Edward was able to cure people who were suffering out of plague and ulcers. Koppalangal. They say that he bequeaths his ability to heal his royal descendants. Avanukku vamsavaliyaga indha gunam vandukittu irukku nu solranga. Along with this strange power, he also has the gift of prophecy and various other abilities. All of these signs mark him as a man graced by God. He is a God's messenger. Now who is coming? A noble kinsman, a relative is coming, who is none other than Ross. Ross comes and gives a report that is about the old news. What is it? Ross was not aware about the murder of Macduff's wife and children. He says that his wife and kids were safe when I left them, right? Many people are rebelling against Macbeth. Ross gives a report that I heard rumors that many good people are arming themselves to rebel against Macbeth. So we need your help. Your presence in Scotland would inspire many people. Please come and fight against Macbeth. Come on. Malcolm says, let them be comfortable. I am returning to Scotland. Gracious King Edward has sent us noble Sigurd and 10,000 soldiers, the young prince. There is no soldier more experienced or successful than Sigurd in the entire Christian world. So I wish I could repay this happy news with good news of my own. Right? What is the news about? This is for me, let me have it now. Macduff says. Now Ross gives another news, the latest news that your wife and children were savagely attacked and slaughtered. Imagine how they were killed will give you more pain. If I told you how they were killed, it would cause you so much pain that it would kill you too and add your body to the pile of murdered corpses. Malcolm cries. Macduff is sick, filled with grief. Come on, man, don't keep your grief hidden. Put your sorrow into words. The grief you keep inside will whisper in your hearts until it breaks. They killed my children too, Macduff cries. They killed your wife, your children, your servants, anyone they could find. Macduff, and I had to be away. My wife was killed too. I said she was. Take comfort. Let's cure this awful grief by taking revenge on Macbeth. Macduff says, he curses Macbeth. He doesn't have children. All my pretty little children. Did you say all? Oh, that bird from hell. All of them. What all my children and their mother did in one fell swoop. Malcolm says, fight it like a man. Be brave. I will. But I also have to feel it like a man. I can't help remembering the things that were most precious to me. Family is everything. Did heaven watch the slaughter and not send down any help? Sinful Macduff, they were killed because of you. He curses himself. As wicked as I am, they were slaughtered because of me, not because of anything they did. May God give their souls good rest. Let this anger sharpen your sword. Transform your grief into anger. Don't block the feelings in your heart. Let them loose as rage. Macduff says, I am not going to weep now. I could go on weeping like a woman and bragging out how I will avenge them. But gentle heavens, don't keep me waiting. Bring me face to face with Macbeth, the devil of Scotland. Put him with the reach of my sword, and if he escapes, may heaven forgive him as well. I am not ready to leave him at all or forgive him at all. Right? So Malcolm was furious and says, I am not going to let him go. Now Malcolm says, you sound like a man. Come on, let's go and see King Edward. The army is ready. All we have to do now is say goodbye to the king. Macbeth is ripe for the picking. We will be acting as God's agents. Cheer up as much as you can. A new day will come at last. So with this, Act 4 of Macbeth comes to an end, right? And we have seen how the wife and the kids of Macduff were brutally murdered by the murderers sent by Macbeth, and Macduff loses all his heart and courage when he hears the news of his wife and children's murders, right? He was in a very sorrowful state. He was in a very pitiful state that his grief knows no boundaries. And Prince Malcolm tries to convince and pacify him. With this, we come to the end of Act 4. Once again, a quick recap of Act 4. We have seen the three witches meeting with Hecate. They were boiling a huge cauldron They were adding up so many things in the cauldron, right? And Macbeth comes and meets them. He demands and commands them to speak out. The witches also speak. Three apparitions started to appear in front of Macbeth. The first apparition means spirit or ghost. The apparition gives a warning saying that you have to be careful about Macduff, the Thane of Fife. That is the first warning given by the first apparition. The second apparition also enters, appears and says, Macbeth, you need not be worried at all, because no man born out of a woman shall ever harm you. You can be bold and brave. Be firm. Don't worry at all. That is how the second apparition predicts. The third apparition also gives a prediction saying that until the Birnam Wood marches to fight you at Dunsinane Hill. Dunsinane Hill is the palace where Macbeth is living. Until the Birnam Wood reaches Dunsinane Hill, you will be never be defeated at all. So be bold. These are the three predictions given by the witches. At the end of the meeting, Macbeth is made to witness a parade of eight kings. And images of eight kings appear in front of him. When the last one was holding a mirror, and finally the ghost of Banquo also appears. Right? And when everything vanishes, Macbeth tries to question them, and he resolves that Macduff should be killed in order to make sure that he can sleep peacefully once Macduff is killed. But in the meantime, in scene 2, Macduff has escaped to England, and only Lady Macduff was living with her children all alone in the castle. Now Ross comes and gives a warning, and Lady Macduff was furious about her husband Macduff, who has left herself as well as his children all alone without any protection. Another messenger also comes and gives a warning that you have to leave the castle immediately because there are some murderers who are planning to kill you all. That is the warning given by the messenger. Again, Lady Macduff ignores the warning given by the messenger and stays back in the castle. She accuses and blames and curses Macduff, that is her husband, for leaving her and her children without any protection in the castle. As warned by the messenger, murderers enter the castle and killed Lady Macduff as well as all the innocent poor children of Macduff. And in scene 3, Malcolm was in England. Macduff has gone to England to meet Malcolm. Macduff informs Malcolm that all the cruel deeds of Macbeth, and he pleads Malcolm to come back to Scotland and fight against Macbeth and come back to power. But Malcolm, as the eldest son of the Prince of Duncan, was not ready to believe in Macduff. He wanted to test him. He says, I am a cruel person. I am a sexual pervert. I am murderers. I am a murderous fellow. I am a cruel fellow. I am a tyrant. I am much worse than Macbeth. So please go away from this place. That is how he wants to chase him out. He says, I am a greedy fellow. I am a lecherous fellow. So please go out. So Macduff loses all hope, but he tries to convince him. But Macduff was totally left out, saying that since Malcolm has also become lecherous and greedy, there is no hope for Scotland to have a good king and to fight against Macbeth. So now Malcolm reveals that I have only tested you, so don't lose your heart. Be bold. I am ready. King Edward is also ready to offer his help along with his young prince named Siward. Siward. He has gathered an army with 10,000 soldiers who were ready to fight against Macbeth. And Ross, another messenger, enters and reports that there are so many other people who were ready to fight against Macbeth. They were all just waiting for an opportunity to fight against him. That is how Ross comes and informs that many people are ready to fight against Macbeth. Please come and fight for Scotland. That is how Ross also comes and informs Malcolm. Ross initially informs Macduff that his family was safe, but later he informed Macduff that his wife and his children were all brutally murdered by the murderers sent by Macbeth. Macduff, on hearing the sad news, was totally dejected and felt stricken with grief that his wife and innocent children were all murdered by the murderers. Right? And Malcolm tried to pacify him, saying that, reserve, just let out all your grief here, be bold and courageous. This is the time you have to join hands with me as well as with the King Edward and his Siward in order to fight against Macbeth. So Malcolm tries to pacify Macduff because he has lost his wife and innocent kids. Right? With this, Act 4 comes to an end. I hope all the three scenes are clearly explained. If you have any doubts, you are free to ask me. Right? Thank you for your patient listening for Act 4.